Thank you, Mark, and other people for inviting me to speak here. It is well known that in the year 802 AD, Sultan Harun al-Rashid sent a white elephant, Abu Abbas, from Baghdad to Aachen as a present for Charlemagne. This was a postal package with very special terms and conditions, and the route was kind of complicated, but the animal arrived in Aachen undamaged. In a 9th century Viking grave in southern Sweden, a small Buddha figure was found that originated from India. Traces of red leather strips can be seen around it that show that the image was carried around for a long time. We don't know how many stopovers it made on its way to Sweden, but this Buddha did make a 5,000-mile journey. And it is always presented as a one-off, but all the garnets used in early medieval Western European jewelry did the same. They all came from India and Pakistan. In Dorestad, or as you say, Dorstad, the Carolingian trade center in the heart of the Netherlands, shirts were excavated from over 23,000 pots from the Rhineland. I have never seen such an endless amount of pale yellow Badorf and reliefment ware, box after box after box. Literally shiploads of the stuff must have traveled downstream the Rhine to Dorestad. These three examples are strong reminders of the fact that we should not underestimate the trade possibilities of the early Middle Ages. But more important, I think we should realize that this global mobility of goods hides an equally global mobility of people. People that escorted the elephant, people that carried the Buddha figure and all the garnets, and people who traded the relief band amphoras and drank its contents. Like trade networks, markets are often treated as abstract concepts. In this paper, I would like to investigate the possibilities of looking into an early medieval market, not as a pile of archaeological objects, but as a place where people interacted and exchanged much more than goods. But let me reintroduce Dorestad to you first. Dorestad was the only Vicus Famosus, famous town, as it's called in Carolingian annals, in the Rhine Delta, and the northernmost river-oriented trading center of the Carolingian Empire. For over 100 years, from the middle of the 8th to the middle of the 9th century, it functioned as a hinge between the Carolingian Empire and the world of the Vikings, and then including present-day Scotland in that world. A place where mobile goods were transferred and shipped. It was wealthy, as is shown by its finds, but it was a center of consumption rather than of production. And it was Christian, as its cemeteries show, but a center of conversion rather than of commemoration. The town was protected and privileged by all Carolingian emperors, from Pippin, who won it over the Frisians in 695, to Lothar I, that had to witness it being set on fire by Vikings in 846, personally. All emperors had silver denarii minted here, on which the town of Dorestad is symbolized by a building in classical style, a cross, or very often a ship, as you see on the right-hand side. These coins spread the fame of Dorestad as a Carolingian Christian trade harbor over the whole world. The excavations of Dorestad, begun in 1840, are still going. Cumulatively, over 50 hectares have been investigated, more than in any other town in the Netherlands. Most recently, at the site called De Geer 2, a cemetery from the 8th and 9th century with over 550 skeletons has been exposed. And before that, in the years 2007-2008, at the site called Veilingterrein, house plans and graves from the 7th century have been excavated. Recent research in the framework of a large exposition on the period of around 400 to 700 AD in Leiden later this year has proven once more that Dorestad was already an important settlement in an international trade network in the Merovingian period, or Anglo-Saxon period if you prefer. Today I will concentrate on Carolingian Dorestad, as I was asked to do, that had a few thousand inhabitants. To compare, Utrecht in this time had only 400, Hedeby had 900, Edinburgh, I don't know, but Paris and Rome each had about 25,000, and Baghdad is said to have over a million in the year 800. And of course, seen from the Mediterranean, we are all smallpox on the fringe of the world. Seen in its northern European context, however, Dorestad was unique. And chronologically, Dorestad was a one-off in Dutch history. There was nothing of this size and importance in the five centuries before, nor in the five centuries after Dorestad. Dorestad owed its wealth to long-distance trade. It could afford to depend on this long-distance trade for even basics like grain and wood. The town was never self-sufficient. For its long-distance trade, it depended on the protection of the Carolingian emperors. The dendrochronological dates of the extensive harbour works of Dorestad show that these were extended in an organised way in the first quarter of the 8th century to serve river navigation better and also to claim land in the river to add to the settlement site. As it seems, only after the death of the Frisian king Radbod in 716 AD did Dorestad really land in the Frankish sphere of influence. The 8th century is the time of Dorestad's ascent, but its real heydays are the first decades of the 9th century, under the protection of Charlemagne and his immediate successors. Their interventions allowed Dorestad to flourish in this time span when other parts of the continent were already suffering from the Vikings. It lasted until 834 AD before Dorestad was attacked. That's very late, really, for a town like this. After that, after 834, the Vikings are recorded to have attacked the town 16 times between 834 and 863, which amounts to every second year. This tells us a lot about the wealth and flexibility of the town that could recuperate quite quickly from these terror attacks. Obviously, there was enough to be found and get there each time. What then were the sources of Dorestad wealth? Between over a million finds from the town, there are remarkable numbers of certain goods. Thousands of Badoff pots, over 2,000 loom weights, over 1,000 parts of Eiffel quernstones, over 400 whetstones, 200 fragments of trachyte mortars, more than 50 fragments of tating jugs, and over 5,000 pieces of amber. And one of the excavators told me that once they made it plain, they sometimes saw it shimmering in the sunlight everywhere, and they just picked up the big pieces. Quite impressive. Remarkable as well is the luxurious glass. It's partly colored glass, also so-called reticella glass, colorful mosaic stones, or tesserae, and glass with gold leaf decoration on it, more than four different vessels with gold leaf decorations. Besides these overwhelming quantities of material, the quality of single products catches the eye. The masterpiece is, of course, this large gilded disc brooch, the Dorestad brooch. And may I remind you that this was actually made in the retarded Carolingian Empire. a large gilded disc brooch, 9 centimeters in diameter, with an inlay of semi-precious stones, pearls, colored glass, and cloisonné enamel. This brooch is only equaled by liturgical goldsmith work in the immediate vicinity of the court of Charlemagne, and thus it connects the doorstep elite with the top of the Carolingian Empire. My research on this brooch in 2008 for the Dorestad exhibition in Leiden pointed out that the disc was a brooch first, but was later, and you can see on the left backside where the pin has actually been removed and filed off, it was later, without its pin, hammered onto something. You can see the holes for the nails on the backside. You can't see them on the front. The stones were put back in place. So I think it was probably on a decorated book cover, or a casket, but maybe a book. And this might point to the presence of a church or monastic treasure. And there are also fragments of similar enamel work from Dorestad to your right, most of them bent, indicating that there must have been more jewelry of this quality around. The finds of these fragments of cloisonné enamel in the neighborhood of a small gold hoard that includes a cut-up gold bar in a quite defendable part of the settlement, to my opinion, might point to a high-quality goldsmith working here. These archaeological finds point to a large bandwidth of goods, of which only a very small percentage can have been produced in Dorestad or its vicinity. And while pots can be traded for their own sake, in this case, it will have been about their contents. This is stressed by the clear overrepresentation of ceramics for keeping, pouring, and drinking liquids. The main product, therefore, were not the vessels, but the wine that was transported in them. In this category, we must also consider the hundreds of wooden caskets that were made from wood in present-day Germany and were reused in Dorestad for the lining of wells, after being emptied, or at least redistributed here. In fact, most ceramics from the Rhineland never made it much beyond Dorestad. From there, the relief bandwares were spread over the whole of Frisia, but in very, very small numbers. Shirts from relief band amphoras are known from the harbors of Medemblik and Domburg, and from the ring forts of Zeeland. It was therefore doubtlessly transported onwards to the west and the north in small numbers that got smaller and smaller once you get further away from Dorestad. But the lion's share, I would say 99%, was broken in Dorestad itself. Only very luxurious and specific things seem to have reached further distances from here. Millstones and tesserae found their way, for instance, to Ribe in Denmark. Rectangular Frankish brooches and black jugs, for instance, to Birka in Sweden, and reticella and gold foil glass to Kaupang and even Borg in Norway. The elite of Dorestad we see in this sword with a gilded, as in the many richly and unnecessarily rich decorated spurs, stirrups, lance heads, and horse harness. While the taste of the elite, is betrayed by the imitation of Roman luxury, and their contacts are given away by Scandinavian jewelry. What is most clear in all these things is that there was a market for showing off, and that would make sense as well in a marketplace to be seen. Of course, depending on preservation circumstances, only certain market goods can be determined archaeologically. Luckily, in the case of Dorestad, that was a Carolingian toll, there are also lists of products on which toll was charged. Those remind us of the famous Frankish shorts and the equally famous Frisian cloth, for which Dorestad was the principal buying place. But it also points towards all the perishable products that were sold at the market in Dorestad. Fur, salt, exotic spices, manuscripts, silk, hunting dogs, and even black slaves. And one of these hunting dogs was, I think, recently identified in the archaeological records, because a complete dog skeleton, researched archaeozoologically, turned out to have been a very large dog indeed, with a shoulder height of about 75 centimeters, bigger than a present-day German Shepherd. And at the moment, we are investigating the possibility of having the isotopes measured of all the Dorestad dog skeletons, as this might allow a conclusion if these dogs were native or not. So if they were hunting dogs from the area or actually hunting dogs traded at the market, or both, probably. And there are over 2,300 human skeletons from Dorestad, probably the largest Carolingian population preserved north of the Alps. These are being investigated by a team from the University of Amsterdam, supervised by archaeoanthropologist Raphael Ponhuizen. And also here, we would like to have the isotopes analyzed of a representative sample, not in the least because one would expect a very mixed population in a place like Dorestad. And to transfer from the abstract to the more concrete, a phrase like a mixed population means that in Dorestad, people from different backgrounds and with different looks actively mingled. And without succumbing to extremes like Viking rape cases or an early medieval Woodstock, it is quite imaginable that somebody might be interested in an exotic other for a number of reasons. The market of Dorestad was seasonal, functioning only when the rivers were navigable. This gave a rhythm to the year. In winter, the population would be basic, and activities largely directed towards household production, purchase and repair Viking damage as well, to be already again when the first ships came in. From that moment, Dorestad would be a permanent coming and going of people from all compass directions, an all-summer fair, and a permanent buzz. Non-perishable goods is all that we can trace, but much more than goods was exchanged at an annual fair like this. Contacts were made or renewed, gifts were given, news were spread, marriages and other bonds were considered. In fact, one of the products traded at Dorestad was Christianity. It is known that people from as far away as Sweden came here to be baptized. In this framework, recent research into the cemetery at the site called the Hull has redirected our attention to this conspicuously large and shallow stone well found there. It was here before most of the graves, and it may well have played an important role in baptism. Its presence indicates that maybe in our quest for church-like structures to indicate Dorestad's religious function, we have overlooked the structures that were really key to this center of conversion. And in this case, let's not forget that conversion was a long and slow process with much room for individual choice. In the cosmopolitan atmosphere of this town, various beliefs may well have warmed up to the ideas of another religion before actually choosing to be baptized. It is known, at least, that there did exist something like a halfway conversion that allowed people to trade with Christian merchants without becoming fully a Christian, and for instance having to give up your slaves at home that were a symbol of status there. This, by the way, also kept the slave trade running, also in Dorestad, that seems to have found a way to function as a transfer market between two non-Christian areas. And you can see how a pragmatic semi-conversion like this would work well for both parties. A few years ago, I asked a linguist if and how the people on the market at Dorestad could talk to each other. His answer was affirmative. They must have. And he drew a comparison with later situations in which groups of people speaking different languages meet each other regularly. For instance, anthropological linguistic research has investigated spoken language on regional markets in thinly populated areas. And in situations like this, a mixed language called a pidgin often arises naturally. It is very functional because the vocabulary is limited, yet practical. For trade goods and selling and buying in particular, there are terms everybody is familiar with. And even when a pidgin is not needed, words and terms are often exchanged at markets, adapted and mixed. Traders sometimes start to use those words at home as well. See what I've bought, and they call it. So the trade language would influence the language at home as well. Besides goods, language must have been exchanged in Dorestad. And within the early medieval trade network, it made communication not only possible, but self-evident. The discussions at the Dorestad Congress in 2009 made it clear that we, as Northern European researchers, have focused way too much on the waterways, thank you, and the relations between Dorestad to the west and the north, that means to Great Britain and Scandinavia. But the supply of goods came from the east and the south. Not only wine and stone over the Rhine in present-day Germany, but stone coffins from the Museland, red wine and manuscripts from northern France, and mosaic stones and silk from Italy. All these journeys included stretches over land. It was obviously possible to conduct these transports regularly and safely enough. But that should not surprise us when we know that it was entirely possible to send an elephant from Arabia to Germany. Not only the elephant, but all gifts between Sultan and Emperor will have been escorted for the whole of their journey. And this already puts us close to the mobility of people in the Carolingian era. Einhard, Charlemagne's biographer, calculated that the emperor during his reign traveled the distance around the earth 3 times. The Frankish annals as well describe the emperor at one time in Rome, then at one of his palaces, the other day on campaign. A typical Carolingian emperor was traveling most of the year with his noblemen and his whole household. At a very different social level, we meet the pious woman Katla from Birka in her legend. As she had heard that there were many poor in Dorestad, and this is typical for big towns, she traveled with 4 other women from Sweden to Dorestad to divide almonies between the poor there. Tired from the day's work, the women drank a glass of wine at an inn in Dorestad. And at night, God replaced in Katla's purse all the silver money they distributed amongst the poor, just not the 4 denarii she spent on the wine. And all well-known sources on Viking attacks can also be read as reports of impressing global journeys of adventurous people who could cross the sea various times a year without much effort. They spent a large part of their lives on the road. Like the powerful, the pious, the soldiers, the merchants, the boatmen, the drivers, the shepherds, and the robbers of the early Middle Ages. I think it might be fruitful when instead of talking only about markets, trade networks, and trade goods, we start considering the free transport of people within an early medieval Europe without borders. Thank you for your attention.